the dawn of the 80s, Athens, Georgia was a sleepy little southern college town with a surprisingly lively art scene, one that had already spawned such new wave bands as the B-52s. Michael Stipe, a low-key art student, and Peter Buck, a guitar-playing music nut, were two new arrivals in town who struck up an unlikely friendship.
We just kind of just started hanging around. I guess we moved in together before we actually had a band together. And we messed around. I think we wrote a couple songs, none of them very wonderful or anything.
They met, actually moved in together and started writing songs like a week before I'd met them. And Mike wasn't with me, but I said, well, you know, this friend of mine's up here, plays bass, you know, we've got bass and drums up here.
Bill and Mike had known each other for a long time, and we just met at this party. We were all really drunk, and it sounded like a good idea, so we did it.
We met Bill and Mike, and then instantaneously, within like an hour, we were a band.
After a few weeks of rehearsal, the nascent band hesitantly decided to attempt a live show, playing a party for friends at an abandoned church where Stipe and Buck happened to be living. The date was April 5th, 1980.
All it took was a party. We just decided to play for a party and have some fun. Wrote 10 songs, got 10 covers, and played for a friend of ours' birthday party.
Having made a successful debut, R.E.M. began venturing out into rock clubs around Athens, where the band's quickly growing repertoire of powerful music soon made it a major local attraction.
Basically, we were just playing around Athens. Then we decided, well, you know, let's go to Atlanta, you know, try that. And it was starting to work, so we started booking tours around the Southeast, and we'd start them on, like, Friday. So we'd take Friday off of school, and maybe the next Monday too, and that started turning into Thursday all to the next Tuesday, and eventually we were all doing quite poorly in school.
I think that the South is a place where you don't have to be professional right away. I mean, you can take 2 or 3 years and play in clubs and bars, and it's not like New York where everyone sees you right off the bat. I mean, we played pizza parlors for a year and a half before anyone had ever heard of us, and it gave us the time to become a good band.
It was get better or die is what it was.
And we just kind of did that for about 2 years. I guess that no one ever actually heard of us until we got signed to IRS in 82?
Yeah.
1982.
In the summer of that year, R.E.M. released an EP called Chronic Town, which immediately bedazzled both critics and college radio, where, as the band undertook its first national tour, the record remained a top five hit for 3 months.
College radio is the place where we're first known.
We've always done really well at colleges, and college radio has been real supportive, but I don't know why we've picked up more fans there than anywhere else.
It's one of three things. They have more leisure time, more money, or they take more drugs, and I haven't decided which one.
In the spring of 1983 came R.E.M.'s first full-fledged album, Murmur, a sensational LP that topped college radio charts and was ultimately named Album of the Year by Rolling Stone magazine, acing out such established acts as U2, The Police, and Michael Jackson.
When we signed our contract with IRS, that was kind of like, wow, man, this is pretty mind-boggling. This wasn't supposed to happen to us. And then as far as success by our own definitions, I think when we put Murmur out, it was something we were all pretty proud of and realized that, hey, there's something here.
The grueling Murmur tour took R.E.M. overseas for its first foreign dates. On returning to the States, the band went right back into the studio to start work on its next album, Reckoning.
Could you never come? I waited for your call. These rivers of suggestion are driving me away.
We did Reckoning in 11 days, recorded and mixed it, and I don't think any of us slept that whole time. It was really insane, and you can really kind of tell it on the record.
R.E.M. was on a roll, though, and supported Reckoning with its biggest and most successful tour to date. But when it came time to record a third album, Fables of the Reconstruction, the band began to falter.
We had a kind of turning inside out of each other with the band, and it came right around the time of Fables of the Reconstruction, and we just, everything got real kind of dark and ugly for a while.
We weren't very happy with that record. The material on it was okay, but the record we just weren't happy with it at all. And we realized that, you know, it's definitely not the money or the commercial success that we're doing this for. It's for the love of the product.
Despite the group's turmoil and the album's darker sound, Fables became R.E.M.'s biggest hit yet.
We were just out of our minds, tired, and there was, it wasn't so much tension between us, it was just general tension. I mean, none of us were very happy, and, you know, we kind of decided, well, we'll just work our way through it, we'll continue to tour. And then we said, we'll work through 85, and then we'll take a little bit of break in 86. And we came back so refreshed with that fourth record that, you know, it was like, that's a new band.
We made this record, Light Switch Pageant, at the end of probably 4 years of cumulative hard work on the road.
We wanted it to have a real good hard edge. We wanted it to rock more than say the last one had.
It did, and it sold more too. Life's Rich Pageant became R.E.M.'s first gold album. But even with its hit single, Fall on Me, the record still couldn't crack the pig-headed resistance of American commercial radio.
We've been around long enough so that all the bands that we were, you know, were supposed to be so much better than us had broken up or died or, you know, are playing in front of 20 people in Alabama, you know, and we're here and, without the hit, without all the, you know, the hype and all that, we've managed to maintain at a fairly high level of, you know, if not success, at least visibility.
I think we probably have the capacity to write a hit song and record it in a way that radio would really accept it with open arms, and that a record company could really get the machine going behind it, and we could be incredibly rich, and, you know, people all around the country would recognize our names. I'm not willing to do that. I don't think that radio deserves me yet.
R.E.M.'s first big crossover commercial hit was just an album away, though, and with it, the band would begin to outgrow the confines of the college rock genre it had helped to create.
Our last record, Life Switch Pageant, did fairly well. We went gold, our first gold record. And, we wanted to kind of capitalize on that success by making a little bit more of a left field type album. It's a little bit more chaotic, and it addresses some political things a little bit more directly, maybe, than we have in the past. We wanted to make a big, kind of noisy record.
R.E.M.'s fifth album, Document, was indeed a big, noisy record, but it also spawned the band's first top 10 single, the often misinterpreted tune, The One I Love.
This one goes out to the one I love. Fire!
The million-selling Document marked the end of an era for R.E.M. It was the band's last album for the independent IRS label, which had nurtured the group from the beginning. In 1988, Michael Stipe and company signed with the giant Warner Brothers Combine and became instant millionaires.
Warner Brothers offered us two things. They offered us massive distribution, and they offered us complete artistic control.
I think that if people want to admire us for anything other than our music, it's for the fact that we have stuck to our guns and said, just know that we want to conduct our lives and our career in this fashion, not in this fashion, and that's the way we've done it.
For us, it was what we did, you know. It was what we wanted to spend our life doing, and as it went along, well, we got more successful, and that was just an accident.
R.E.M.'s major label debut was an album called Green, which revealed a broadened lyrical outlook that took in the entire planet.
Well, clearly the environment has become a really big issue, and we saw Green, the album, as a way to tie in our concerns with that and, you know, make sense.
Should we talk about the weather? Should we talk about the government? Stand in the place where you were, now face with us.
Boosted by the top five hit single, Stand, R.E.M.'s Green album was a massive success, and the band hit the road to promote it with a tour that lasted nearly a full year.
The Green World Tour in 89 was 11 months of touring, and it took us about a year, all of 1990, to recuperate from that, and
write the next record, and we were just exhausted.
We sold a lot of records, we made a lot of money on that tour, and we made it that long kind of with the thought that we'd be able to free ourselves up for the next 2 or 3 years to do really whatever we wanted to. So we took our time writing the songs, knowing that it was going to be hard for us, the guitar-based band that we're known as, to just kind of reapproach the songwriting process. But we did, and it took a little longer, and we knew it would.
Well, the new record is by far the best thing that we've ever done, the best record we've ever made. And it's probably going to redefine pop history, I think, in America and worldwide.
In March of 1991, R.E.M. released Out of Time. And while it may not have redefined pop history, it did redefine the band's approach to its music and its career.
I love guitar, but I was kind of in danger of becoming very competent, or almost competent, you know, which, I mean, for me, songwriting is the main thing I do. And to keep it fresh, it's nice to try different instruments.
We wanted to avoid the guitar, pretty much. You know, we'd live with the big rock and roll lineup, playing the arenas and stuff, and they allowed, you know, kind of impersonality of playing those big, huge situations. We wanted to leave that behind. It was fun, but we, you know, the 90s needed to be something different for us.
That's me in the corner. That's me in the spotlight. Losing my religion. Trying to keep up you.
It was an incredible challenge for me to write the type of songs that I've always despised. I find love songs odious, and they're something that I've avoided writing about for the entire history of R.E.M. because I just think that they're so common. There's so many love songs. They're so poorly written.
Out of Time also marked the first time that R.E.M. brought outsiders into its tightly knit fold to help out.
I met KRS-One in Washington, and when it came time to record Out of Time, we had radio song, and it was just missing something. There was a voice there that, you know, wasn't around, and we thought of KRS-One, so I called him up, and he was thrilled to be able to do it.
Damn that radio song! Hey, hey, hey. Hey, hey, hey. Everything to show. Everything to hide. Look into my eyes. Listen to the radio. I turned up the radio.
Went to Radio City Music Hall in New York to see the B-52s play, and on the steps between the set and the encore, I grabbed Kate and I said, "You've got to be on our next record." And she said, "I'd love to." So we wrote the songs, and we tried to figure out where we could fit her in, and Shiny Happy People seemed like it was custom made for her to sing on, so we brought her in on it.
Time was an enormous commercial and artistic success for R.E.M., garnering 3 Grammy Awards and 6 MTV Video Music Awards. After 10 years of hard, uncompromising work, the little band from Athens, Georgia was finally swimming in the mainstream. Spending most of the 1980s on the road in support of various albums, R.E.M., as the decade came to an end, was ready to make a change.
We had an idea when we were even recording Green that after the next record we weren't going to want to tour, just because we wanted to break that pattern. We wanted to shake up this thing we've been kind of locked into. I mean, it's almost 3 years between Green and Out of Time because we were on tour. We don't want that to happen again. And we really feel like we're on a roll. In the studio, this record was a blast to make. And we kind of want to keep that energy and go in and do another one right away.
We didn't think too much about Out of Time and all the awards that it had gotten while we were doing this. We just knew that we wanted to make a strong record. We also knew that once we started listening to the songs that we had written for this, we knew it would be different, because the songs were very different.
R.E.M.'s follow-up to the smash hit Out of Time album was a completely different sort of record called Automatic for the People.
This record is different from Out of Time primarily in that the songs are musically slower, mid-tempo, and lyrically rather introspective. They're very inward-looking and to an extent a bit somber and occasionally melancholy.
This record was a nine-month metamorphosis, which was, and it went from, you know, being a caterpillar to being a rat to being a dog to being a chicken. I mean, it went all over the place.
This is an acoustic record, lots of keyboards, less drums. We tried to keep anything off of this that we didn't think was really necessary. You know, there's nothing gratuitous on there.
What if I ride? What if you walk? What if you rock around the clock?
It's funny because when we were thinking about the record over a year ago, we were saying, well, maybe we'll do a couple of live tracks with like seven or eight or nine musicians in one room. That didn't work out. We saw the songs were smaller and more intimate, so we kept we played everything ourselves except things we can't play, strings.
To write string charts for Automatic for the People, R.E.M. called upon former Led Zeppelin bassist and arranger John Paul Jones.
You know, Led Zeppelin was a great band, and I've always really liked the string arrangements that he did.
John Paul Jones really added an extra element to this record that the last one didn't have, even though it had strings. Those are basically our string parts that we kind of hummed along to the symphony, and they kind of struggled with it. But John Paul Jones came in with, you know, charts and definite ideas, and he really directed that portion of the record.
He did say one thing about an organ thing that I did on one of the songs, and that was as flattered as I've ever been. He said, "Nice touch on the organ." I was like, "Oh, thank you very much." You know, that made my day.
Automatic for the People.
Automatic for the People is a slogan for Weaver D's soul food restaurant in Athens, Georgia.
They liked the slogan. They wanted to use it as the title of the album. This is really great, you know, and I was just so happy. I think it's been a smile on my face ever since then.
What it means in terms of the restaurant, it means that you walk in, you get a plate of food, you say, "I'd like some pork chops and greens." He goes, "Automatic." So it just means that, you know, that he's got some food, it's gonna be good, and you can have it. Well, here's a record, we think it's good, and you can have it. You know, it's that sort of thing.
Ever loyal to its locale and its cadre of supporters, R.E.M. once again called in Scott Litt, who'd worked on all the group's albums since Document, to co-produce Automatic for the People.
Well, first of all, he understands us. He's willing to push us, but doesn't push us in a commercial way. He pushes us in a more creative way.
Everything we've done, we co-produced with Scott Litt, just the same as the last three records before this, but they all sound different. I guess it's because we do them in different places, because we have, you know, different songs every time. Maybe our attitude is different every time. But each record sounds different enough from the previous one to keep working with Scott.
R.E.M.'s commitment to the four equal creative voices within the group has helped to keep the band's lineup unchanged for 12 long years.
R.E.M. to me is a marriage, I guess. That's the only way I can describe it. It's a marriage in that there's a great deal of love involved, both among ourselves and for what we do. It's a marriage in that you have to work at it.
R.E.M. for me is first, I mean, even before the music, is three, they're my best friends. And we actually love each other. And everything that comes out of us creatively, I think, is a reflection of that respect for each other. There's a lot of give and take. We have to see a lot of things in common, but of course we butt heads at times too.
R.E.M. was never interested in simple rock stardom. The band's commitment all along has been to bending the accepted rules of the pop music business in order to do things its way.
I think what we're doing, if anything, is showing people that you can, in fact, do it your way. And you don't have to listen to everyone who tells you, well, you've got to wear fancy clothes, you've got to have fancy hair, you have to go open for these well-known acts in large arenas. None of those things have to be done.
I just feel really fortunate to be able to work with people that are as talented
and it's logical and full of common sense. I mean, it's amazing. And of course, the music I'm very proud of. And I think it is fairly timeless music that kind of holds its value. You know, I can still listen to Murmur and go, God, yeah, that's a pretty good record. And a lot of other people do too, and that makes me really proud.
We decided the next record is to have no acoustic instruments, and we're going to lock like all the pump organs and mandolins and dulcimers in a closet and make a rock and roll record.
We're going to probably do one more record next year sometime and go out after that. We'll have 3 records worth of material that we've never played live. We'll have completely forgotten about the 1989 tour, and we'll be ready to go out again.
Monopoly 21, checkers and chess. Yeah, 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 yeah. Mr. Fred Lassie in a breakfast mess. Yeah, 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 yeah. Let's play Twister, let's play